In this video, we will present you the laser triangulation, which is a 3D technique used to have 3D information of an object. We will talk about the concept of this technique and how it works, about the challenges that the market is currently facing, and how to solve them. Here you have a very simple classification of the 3D imaging technologies to help us to explain where we stand technology-wise. They are divided into two categories. On one hand, there are the active systems which need a dedicated light source, such as time of light, laser triangulation, structured light, and interferometry techniques. And on the other hand, there are the passive systems like stereo. These multiple 3D techniques enable to achieve different levels of performances in terms of distance range, precision, etc. And there is a high dependency between the application requirements and the most appropriate 3D solution. At Teledyne E2V, we focus our 3D activities on two main techniques, time of light and laser triangulation, those which, in our opinion, require more innovation at the sensor level. Laser triangulation is suitable for a wide range of applications, from the inspection of big objects, for example in road inspection, to small objects, like in PCB inspection. It can be used to detect very small defects, down to micrometer, like in PCB inspection, or to have a rough idea of the object size, like in volume inspection for logistics. This technique can also be used to inspect objects that are moving at very high speed, for example to inspect trains in motion. The camera can be movement, for example when the camera is held by a robot or by a person, but it can also be fixed and the object in movement, for instance when inspecting pieces that are on the conveyor belt, that will be our example today. In laser triangulation, the object that we want to inspect is moving following the y-axis and is scanned by the camera. A laser line is projected onto the object, and due to the difference of height of the different parts of the object and of the angle between the laser and the camera, the projected laser lines forms a laser profile that is imaged in the 2D pixel array, and this for each scan. In each image, which represents a 3D slice in the Y direction of the object, the row within every column X represents the height Z of the object at that point. At system level, a calibration is required to translate the pixel unit to distance unit. There are different techniques of laser triangulation, where the camera and the laser have different angles in relation to the normal plane, each with different pros and cons. All the examples of this presentation will be made with a standard geometry, which is the most common. What are the challenges that the market is facing? The high speed of modern production line requires high speed scanning measurement. The increased importance of quality control requires to detect defects that are smaller and smaller. The variety of materials that can be controlled at the same time requires to be able to detect well the high reflective and low reflective material. We saw what are the challenges that the market is facing. There are three of them that are to measure with an increased precision, to measure more at the same time, and to measure all kinds of surfaces. Before to enter in the details of each challenge, we must note that the range and the resolution in X, Y, and Z are given by the combination of several parameters. The horizontal resolution and vertical resolution of the sensor speed, the optical system, and the angle between optical axis of the camera and the laser. The first challenge we note was to measure with an increased precision. Laser triangulation is a high precision technique, enabling achieving even submicron accuracy. Camera vendors have their own algorithm and optical expertise to maximize the precision, but the image sensor has a lot to say here, as we will see now. We will segment this challenge in three parts, one for each axis. To measure with an increased precision in the X-axis is quite trivial. we need to increase the horizontal resolution of the sensor. Indeed, the more pixels there are on the horizontal resolution, the higher the precision in this direction. Here, we can see that by adding pixels that are represented by the dark lines, we increase the horizontal resolution of the system. To measure with an increased precision in the z-axis is the same principle. In order to increase the precision in the z-axis and keeping the same angle between the laser and the camera, we need to increase the vertical resolution of the sensor. Thus, the granularity will be smaller when acquiring the profile, and so the precision of the measurement is improved. For the y-axis, it is a bit different. Indeed, the measure of this axis is not given by the resolution of the sensor, but by the speed of the belt and by the frame rate of the sensor. For each image acquired by the sensor, we have a profile that gives the values for x and z dimension for a given slice in the y direction, and so the y resolution is given by the displacement of the object between two slices. On the diagram, all the triangles represent a scan of a slice. Due to this, to measure with an increased precision in the y-axis, we have to increase the frame rate of the sensor in order to reduce the time, and so the distance between two consecutive profiles. This is represented in the diagram by the dark triangles. The second challenge we note was to measure more at the same time. As for the previous one, we will segment the challenge in three parts for the three axes. For the x-axis, we will take the example of smartphone inspection. To measure more at the same time in the x direction, we can increase the field of view. This allows, as on the example, to inspect two devices at the same time. But we can also imagine an example where we can inspect an object with only one camera instead of two, and thus we can reduce the number of systems that are required, and so the associated cost. However, the negative point of this is that increasing the field of view, we are losing resolution. The dark blue arrow is much smaller than the light blue one, but to solve this, we can increase the horizontal resolution of the sensor. We can now measure two devices at the same time, having the same resolution per device as before. With the z-axis, we will take an example in logistics, in which we want to measure the size of boxes. Here, we can see that the camera has the wall laser in the field of view, and so it can measure the size of the box. However, if a bigger box comes on the belt, we can see that the camera cannot measure its size since a part of the profile is out of the field of view. A possibility for that can be to add a second camera on top of the first one, but we can also increase the vertical field of view of the camera. Thanks to this, we can measure the size of the bigger box as well. However, as for the x-axis, we have now a lower resolution. To solve this, we can increase the vertical resolution of the sensor. For the y-axis, as for the first challenge, it's a bit different. To measure more at the same time in this axis, we can increase the speed of the conveyor belt. With this, we will measure more pieces during a given time. However, the distance between two profiles is now bigger than before, and so we lost in terms of resolution. To compensate this loss, we can increase the frame rate of the sensor in order to capture more profiles during this given time. In our example, we have now four profiles for each piece, idest as before, but we can also measure two pieces during this given time. However, there is a strong trade-off between the vertical resolution and the scanning speed, and thus between the resolution in the axis Y and Z. Indeed, if you reduce the number of lines, you increase the frame rate because you can reduce the amount of information that is read. On this example of profile that we can get in laser triangulation, we can see that on the top and on the bottom of the sensor, a lot of lines are not useful. We can in this case do a ROI in order to reduce the number of lines that are read to increase the frame rate. The main point is the following. Usually, in this trade-off, the speed is favored against the number of lines by laser triangulation users, and thus a big number of lines is not necessary. Furthermore, to reduce or to limit the number of lines at sensor level also has advantages, such as to save silicon and so to have cheaper sensor, or to allow to use smaller optics that helps to reduce the system cost. Now, you may think of cases in which we do need to have a big range because we want to inspect big objects, for example with the last example of logistics. However, in most of the cases, when you measure big objects, you do not need to be very accurate, and so the number of columns that is required can be reduced at system level. Indeed, here comes the effect and the importance of the angle between the laser line and the camera. If you reduce the angle alpha, the profile is less stretched, so the precision is a bit lower, but less lines are necessary to see the same object. Due to this, the aim at sensor level is to have enough line to be able to see the whole object we want to inspect and with an acceptable precision, but not too much. Indeed, it is possible to use the same sensor for different ranges by using different angles at system level. Also, it is very important to have a very high frame rate even at full frame to do not have to trade off speed and resolution from the beginning. The last challenge is to be able to measure all kinds of surfaces. The picture you see on the right side is a very common issue in laser triangulation that appears when both low and high reflective material are inspected at the same time. We can see here that we do not know where the laser is. A much higher dynamic range is required to solve this. Basically, we would need a very high full well capacity in the pixel. One possibility to increase it is for example to do binning, which increases the full well capacity by n square and the noise by n. With a 2x2 binning, it increases the full well capacity by 4 and the noise by 2 and thus the dynamic range by 6 dB. However, even if binning is very interesting because it allows to increase the speed by 4, it also reduces spatial resolution by 4 and it increases the dynamic range by only 6 dB, that is normally not enough for this application. Another possibility is to increase directly the full well capacity of each pixel. However, to have a plus 20 dB in linear mode and considering we can keep the same noise, it is required to increase the full well capacity by 10, that is a lot. For plus 40 dB, we have to increase it by 100, that is even more complicated. Therefore, a HDR technique is necessary to increase the dynamic range to an acceptable value, and we will see one later in this video. In this part, we saw how to answer the three challenges. To measure with an increased precision, we increase the resolution. To measure more at the same time, we increase the frame rate, and to measure all kinds of surfaces, we increase the dynamic range. However, we also saw that it is not that simple and that there are links and trade-offs between the parameters for the two first challenges. To increase the horizontal resolution can help to measure with an increased precision in the x-axis or to measure more at the same time, while to increase the frame rate can help to measure more at the same time or to measure with an increased precision in the y and z-axis. Of course, it is also possible to do a combination of all these improvements. To answer these challenges, Teledyne E2V developed a familiar sensor called Flash that is specifically tailored for laser triangulation application. Flash has the highest speed at as high resolution in the market. For 8 bits, the frame rates are up to 1800 fps at 4K by 1K resolution for Flash 4K and 1500 fps at 2K by 1K resolution for Flash 2K. On the right side is the comparison with the sensor of the competition for 10 bits, and the one above compares the speed achievable by the different sensor with 1024 lines, and below the maximum number of lines to reach 10,000 fps. As you can see, with 1K lines, Flash has a much higher speed than the competition, and at very high speed like 10K FPS, Flash can still use nearly 150 lines, while the sensor from the competition need to reduce the number of lines to a number between 50 and 100 for the best of them. There are also feature-rich sensors, with the HDR features that we will see just after embedded on chip, the vertical flipping, several analog gains control, different trigger modes, and the availability of different framing modes to have the information in 8 or 10 bits. Also, Flash has the best ratio gigabit per second over price in the market, combined with standard optics compatibility, IPS-like for the 4K and C-mount for the 2K. On top of that, ROI and binning are available to increase even more the speed if necessary, combined with hot changes that allows to change some parameters for each frame, which allow a lot of flexibility. Flash sensors are also designed to allow many kinds of derivative and customization to perfectly fit your application needs. The last trade-off made on Flash is on the pixel pitch. Flash embeds a 6 micron pixel that is the perfect trade-off between big pixels that allows a higher sensitivity and a higher speed and small pixel that allows to save silicon and to use smaller and cheaper optics and so cheaper system. Some derivatives that can trade off the speed, resolution and the price are also available if there is an interest for your application. All these parameters are the characteristics of flash sensors. Here you can see again the picture we saw earlier in the presentation, where both very reflective and low reflective surfaces are seen on the same capture. This is an issue because we do not see where the laser is. The well adjustment technique that is used on flash allows to capture images of moving objects in a single capture, without any motion blur. Indeed, some HDR techniques use two or more pictures to build the HDR image, and since the object is moving between the different captures, there is a motion blur on the image. With this technique, only one picture is required, so there is no motion blur, and it is also possible to go faster. Thanks to the HDR, it is possible to find reliably the laser peak on virtually any kind of surface. On the second picture, we clearly see the laser both on the low and high reflective parts. Now, we saw the solutions to answer the challenges the market is facing. First, to increase the horizontal resolution without having a too high vertical resolution, such as 2K by 1K and 4K by 1K rectangular sensors. This allows to reduce the footprint of the sensor, and so it helps to reduce both the price of the sensor and the price of the system. Secondly, to have a very high-speed full-frame sensor, running at 1800 FPS and even more with ROI or binning. For example, more than 6600 FPS with a ROI of 256 draws, and more than 6900 FPS with a 2x2 binning, IDEST a resolution of 2K by 500 pixels of 10 micron. Last, a HDR feature embedded on chip that allows to measure all kinds of surfaces thanks to its up to 100 dB dynamic range. This is a unique sensor family specifically tailored for the laser triangulation application, Flash. The Flash family is a standard offer, but it can be customized to enable differentiation. There are software derivatives, such as the possibility to increase the full well capacity of the pixel, or the low power mode that can trade off the frame rate with the number of LVDS and the power consumption, for example if you want to use less LVDS or if the power consumption is important for your application. There are also hardware derivatives with the possibility to add a custom color filter array or a custom micro lenses array on the sensor. Another hardware derivative that we propose is regarding the shame flow angle. Indeed, laser strangulation normally requires that the optical system is not perpendicular to the sensing plane, but tilted with a certain angle, as in the picture. This is called the Shemflow principle. This angle implies a loss of signal due to the angular response of the sensor that can be quite significant when angles are big. But it can be compensated through a simple derivative specifically adapted for the angle you use in your application. But Teledyne E2V is not only a sensor seller and also proposes some tools that are useful to evaluate and integrate flash sensors. To evaluate flash on our technology, we propose an evaluation kit. Its camera-like architecture allows to easily evaluate the electro-optical performances of the sensor with virtually any laptop or notebook thanks to its USB 3 interface and can also be perfectly used for end customer demo and proof of concept. We also propose a reference design to help you to design your system to save valuable time and resources and to drastically improve the time to market. It is conceived to be used as a working reference during the development and it contains the source code of the evaluation kit including PCB, FPGA code and embedded software. Finally, we have a strong local and directly technical support that is available in your region and that is available to help you during your design. Thank you very much for your attention during this video and if you have some questions, do not hesitate to contact us.